Hey, welcome to Square Body Stuff. I'm Chad. In this video, we're going to be getting some work done on our little Nitrous 339 stroker build. To catch you up real quick on this build, if you're new to this channel, if you're not familiar with what we're doing, I've got a 305 that I am putting a 3.75 inch stroke, which is a 383 crankshaft, if you was to put it in a 350 block. But if you put it in a 305 block, depending on your bore size, you'll end up with a 334 would be 30 over, can't remember what 40 is, but 339 is 60 over, and that's where we're going. My block was really wore out, and I decided, well, I know it's not going to clean up 30. If we're going to go 40, we might as well go 60. I filled the block with block fill, or half filled it. I got videos on all that stuff. All this stuff is in a playlist of for Squeaky, the truck that's going into my 78 step side. I'm also going to be... I should have another playlist going for engine related stuff. So I might just start a whole nother playlist on the 339 stroker build, because I'm gonna try to do some fairly involved videos on it, how I do stuff. Now, I'm not a professional engine builder. I've built several in my lifetime. I have my certain ways of doing things, and I have my certain tools that I use. I don't have the best facility for it. I'd like to have my own clean room where it stays clean and away from everything else. So, you know, nothing's as clean as what I'd like it to be. I get it as clean as I possibly can, even during, you know, just cleaning up and checking, inspecting parts like we're doing today. Try to keep everything clean. That's like number one key rule to building engines or doing anything like that. Keep everything clean. So, go check out the playlist, catch yourself up on what we're doing with Squeaky and this engine. We're going to be playing with some rods and pistons today. And as I go through, I'll kind of explain what the parts are, where they came from. Yeah, I'll try to break it down without dragging this video out too long. The rods and pistons deal, which I'm not really going to be doing much with the pistons in this video. The pistons are just kind of, I'm trying to get a system going in this shop with what I've got going on, so I'm just trying to lay stuff out, seeing, get a good pattern going. That's another key to engine building or doing mechanic work, trying to get, you know, stuff together, is try to get a pattern, especially when you're doing multiples of stuff. We're doing, you know, 8 each of everything. Of course, the bearings are 16 bearings. A gob of rings that you're going to have to deal with, which at this point we're not worried about the rings. But yeah, it's establish a pattern, and I'm going to try to go over that, what works for me. And you can do whatever works best for you, but try to get a pattern going so you don't lose track of where you're going. Because if you're in the middle of something and the neighbor pulls up and you got to go talk to him, or you get a phone call, then you get back to it, you're not lost. You can kind of look at where you are and know where to start back from and where you ended up at. So I'll show you that too. I'll kind of explain that. But I've got a lot of stuff I'm gonna try to cram in this video without stretching it out too long. It may be a long video. By the time you click on this and start watching it, you'll know how long it is. And feel free to fast forward through anything. But try to be as information full. Try to have as much information in this as I possibly can. Again, the way I do things. I've done pretty good on the engine build. Not going to, you know, I guess toot my own horn a little bit, but really no failures. So let's get into it. The first thing I'm going to do is I've got one of the old pistons and rods with the rings in it. It was a standard bore, just your standard 305 rod and piston. We're going to weigh it on this scale, which, yes, it's a cheapie from Harbor Freight. Some stuff, not really worried about absolute accuracy. It's repeatability, and you weigh one thing on it, the next thing, you know, even if you may be off a tenth of a gram, or, of course, it only goes down to grams, it's not that that precise. But so far, it seems to be pretty accurate. I can weigh one thing several times, and it repeats itself. So that's the main thing I'm worried about. So we're gonna weigh the factory rod and piston, and then I'm gonna set the aftermarket stuff up on there and see what the weight difference is. So before I get to weighing these, put in the comments below what you think is gonna weigh less, the factory stuff or the new stuff, which of course it's not fair. You haven't really seen what the new stuff is yet, but nice I-beam rods, through bolt caps, nice flat top forged pistons. These are heavy duty pins, so they're a little bit beefier. And of course the bearings, probably a wash between those and factory. So, but we've also got these little guys, the locks for the pin. So what do you think? Which is gonna weigh more? I'm gonna turn the scale on, maybe. There we go. And we're on grams. So I'm gonna go ahead and set the bearings on there because those will be the same for either one. I'm just gonna leave those bearings on there. Okay, now I think I'm gonna weigh the new stuff first just to keep this clean and not put the dirty stuff on first. You know what I'm getting at. Throw the rings on there. Real quick, let's do this just for science, I guess. Piston ring pin package is 564 grams. Then we add the bearings. Then we add the beefy goodness of the rod. All right, 1,319 grams. Now what I'll do is I'm gonna kind of tap it. Just sometimes, there we go. All right, it keeps going back to that. I'm gonna put it back at zero. So if we take all this stuff off, except for the, and we go ahead and take the bearings off, 1,319. All right, we're cooking with some good peanut oil now. And we'll set that on there. Okay, we're positive 30 grams. So the old stuff is actually heavier, 30 grams heavier than the new stuff. Huh, that's good news. Now, I think let's weigh the crankshafts. Now, it won't be very scientific other than it's a bathroom scale and it's digital. That's about the best I can do right now for something that heavy. I'm gonna weigh the stroker crank first. I'm not sure if you can see that. I'm not sure if it shows up in the camera because it's just kind of flashing on my screen. So, and I didn't read it before it went off. It's showing 51.2. Let me try it again. All right, 51.2 both times. Now, you think the factory crank is going to be lighter or heavier? I really don't have a clue. I'm hoping the aftermarket crank is lighter. We all do, I guess. Well, just going by my feel, feels like the factory one's quite a bit heavier. I tried putting the same spot. It says 52.6. All right, 52.6. So after putting my thinking cap on, I've done some figuring. and we come up with, this is the aftermarket stuff, this is the stock stuff, that's the difference in the weight, which we come up to almost 2 pounds lighter for the aftermarket stuff. Now that's, I think, pretty considerable for spinning around at 7,000 RPM. Of course, that's rotating and reciprocating mass together. But still, yeah, that's a pretty significant difference on the internals of this little stroker motor. All right, before we go any further, I'm gonna show you what we got as far as parts. We'll start off with the bearings. They are King bearings, King Racing bearings. Of course, you know, it's got racing in the name, so they gotta be good. But they're the P-Max Blacks. The P-Max Blacks are a tri-metal or tri-layer, whatever you want to call them. You can go look them up on their website and figure out all the different metallurgy and goodies that they've got going on in these things. But these are what I chose for my application. They're good for extreme pressures and a lot of abuse. We'll move on to the connecting rods next. Yes, these are Speedmaster, or actually PCE, the Pro Comp rods. They're a good I-beam rod. Supposed to be good for 1,000 horsepower. I read a lot of reviews on these before I did purchase them, and there's a lot of guys that really love these rods. Fit and finish, they may not be as good as some of them, some of the other brands, but I'll probably, even if there was the best of the best, I'd probably still go over them and double check them and make sure it didn't have any rough edges or anything like that. They got the bronze pin end for floating pin, 7/16 through bolts. They're supposed to be, you know, they got the heavy or the big chamfer for the radius on your crankshaft. They're a 6-inch rod. And let's see, that's pretty much the goods on that. They're 43/40 forged. So yeah, they're supposed to be able to handle everything we're gonna throw at it with this little 305. All right, let's go over these bad boys. Those guys are from DSS Racing, based out of St. Charles, Illinois. Everything's made in-house. They machine everything, all that, made in USA. Great people to work with. They hooked me right up and got them to me within 2 weeks of when I ordered them. Great people to work with. I talked to Nick, so if anybody goes, calls them up, ask for Nick. He's a great guy. I worked with him. I don't know. Sorry for anybody else that might work there. I never talked to you. But I talked to Nick. He helped me out a bunch. He's actually subscribed to my channel now. So thanks, Nick. But here's all the specs on this for a 375 stroke, 6-inch rod. Of course, there's the bore, 3976 or 3796. They are a 40-32. If I'm wrong on that, I'll put it at the bottom of the screen. I think they're 40-32 forging. They got a little more silicon in the aluminum. These are going to work great for me. Again, with these pistons, there's been guys that's said they've made over 1,000 horsepower with these particular pistons. Maybe not with the 305, but this piston in a different application, they've handled up to 1,000 horsepower. So this combination here should hold together with what we're doing with this little motor. They've got this X-ring or X-groove technology. I found a little video that I will post after we get done talking about these, which not a whole lot more to talk about the pistons. I'll tell you what the rings are, and then I'll put this little clip of their little video that explains their X-ring stuff that's going on there. They got a lot of good stuff going on with these pistons. They have two more steps above this, and they are the 2618, I believe, forgings, which is a lower silicon, and they have a higher expansion rate and stuff like that, but they're for bigger applications. I didn't see the point in going that far with them. The extreme ones have gas ports, extreme duty wrist pins. These are heavy duty wrist pins. Everything looks great on them. Just Yeah, I can't thank DSS enough for the help they did, because they got these things to me. I was worried I wouldn't be able to get them in time. Let's move on to the rings real quick. 1.2, 1.2, 1.2. We'll move on to the rings real quick before we get in that video. 1.2 millimeter top and second ring, 3 millimeter oil ring package, extreme power adder steel rings. They're for boost or nitrous application, which all nitrous is liquid boost. They are oversized for my bore, because you know we've seen down here it's a 3796 bore. These are 380 bore. They're file fit, so I'll have to make sure I get my, you know, get my rings gapped just the way I want them, and that way we can handle some extra pressure. So that's the big skinny on what we got going on as far as parts that I've been showing so far. I'll show you that little video on their X-Groove technology, and then we'll get to the what we're going to be doing next. The next thing we're going to be going over is the next step of the process. Once you get everything kind of laid out, get organized. Right now, I'm going to be just inspecting everything. I'm going to go inspect my bearings, inspect the rods, inspect the pistons, go down through, make sure everything looks good, and I'm going to wipe them off, make sure there's nothing bad on them, make sure there's no boogers or anything on there that I don't like. Now's the time to find it and address the situation from there. The reason I have these set up the way I do is to establish that pattern. As I was saying earlier in the video, if you could get organized and kind of establish a pattern when you're working with multiples of things, you won't lose track of what you're doing. And you know, if you get dragged away, you'll kind of know where you're at whenever you come back to it, if you get sidetracked with something else. So the reason why I have these staged the way I do is if I go down here, I'm checking my bearings out, wiping them off, I'll stand them up. When I get done with that one, I'll check this one, make sure it's good, stand it up. Check my rod out, everything looks good on it, I'll turn it the other way. Same thing with my piston, I'll pull it out, pull the pin out, make sure everything's good on it. I'll flip it over and set the pin inside of it. Then I'll just keep going on down the line. So when I'm in the middle of this and I'm halfway through and I'm getting ready to start this set, these are all done. They're all flipped over like that. We'll imagine that. We'll play imagination. And I'm looking at this bearing and I flip it over. Well, like my phone rings or someone pulls up and you gotta go talk to somebody, or you know, whatever the case may be. When you come back to it and get refocused on what you're doing, all you gotta do is say, oh, well, these are all flipped over. This bearing's like those. That one is like these, so I need to start with this bearing, and then start your process from there. You're not, you know, oh crap, where did I end up? Did I look them over? Did, you know, you hit everything. And then when you get down to the end and everything's done and everything's looks the same, then you know you've got everything done. And then, you know, that same process, just kind of clean and inspect. And then you can go through, if there's anything you want to, you know, deburr or, you know, really address, same thing. You get done with this bearing, you lay it flat. Just have a good process. I'm not saying this is the only way to do it. This is the way I tried to do it. You know, whatever works best for you guys. But the main thing is find a pattern, try to stay as clean as possible, and have fun. That's the biggie. Enjoy what you're doing. Don't get stressed out about it. If you do find an issue, you know, see how bad it is. Is it something that you can address and fix, or is it something you need to call the manufacturer and say, hey, you know, I've got this issue with it. You know, don't go to Facebook and say, hey, what do I do? I've got a rod that's got a burr on it. You know, these things are junk. And because the first thing most people are going to ask you, well, did you call the company? And if you say no, then, you know, that's the first thing you need to do. If you have an issue with any of your parts, call the manufacturer. They have, most of them have pretty good sales reps or tech or whatever you want to call them to help you out. And if they don't, well, I apologize for that. Nothing I could do about that. But at least you've done your part. You've tried to get them to fix the situation. After that, then you can maybe turn to, you know, third party help. You know, well, the company ain't helping me, and, you know, see what you can do. So, but this is the time to do it. Inspect your parts, make sure everything's good, because you don't want to be sticking this thing together and then find a nick in your ring groove or something like that. You know, you want to find it now. All right, folks, I think that's going to be a good spot to end this video off. So I don't drag it out too long. Of course, one thing I want to note, I don't know if anybody noticed, but this part of my workbench is actually cleaned off. You know, I'll be pretty proud of me, because I'm a real bad person to just end up with that. You know, just throw it down. I keep my main table cleaned off, but everything else is just ends up a catch-all. I'm trying to better myself. So got that spot cleaned off so I can use my vise to put the rods in. But yeah, that's all I really want to go over with in this video. I hope it helped somebody out. I hope it's educated somebody. If you have any questions, hit me up in the comments. And again, this is how I do stuff. This is not set in stone how you have to do everything. Every engine builder's got their own little tricks and tips and stuff that they do to make the process easier for themselves. So I'm just showing you mine. Hopefully it'll help somebody. The next video, we're going to be getting into breaking these rods down, putting the bearings in, and start measuring for our oil clearance. I'll have the crankshaft up there cleaned up and miking every journal and stuff. Then we'll go over that in the next video. That's one of the steps of checking everything out. I'll have everything cleaned up, you know, deburred if I want to deburr anything, and we'll be ready to start measuring stuff out and start writing it down and documenting, you know, our build. Again, I appreciate you guys watching, sticking through this with me, because this is not a normal build. I've gone over that several times in other videos. This is not, not something I'm saying, hey, this is the next big thing. This is going to take LS's, you know, out of the mix. Now, this is fun. It's building something different. I'm having fun with it. I think you guys are enjoying it. So I'm trying to put as much effort into it as I possibly can, show you guys everything, and just take you along for the journey. So let's have fun with it. That's the big thing. Have fun with whatever you do. So I'm going to break it off here before I ramble on anymore. So until next time, y'all, keep your square bodies rolling, and we'll catch you later.